Check. Waymaker again.
Do you want us to sing that too?
No, just let it be the soprano. Yeah, let it be the soprano, and then tenor, and then as wounds which mar the chosen one. I think that's when you guys come in. As wounds which mar the, we'll go over that in just a second. Okay. So, let's do Waymaker.
Turning into me.
From the get-go.
Turning into me.
Waymaker. One, two,
you are here, moving in our midst.
You are here,
moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you.
Let's start again from the top. One, two, three.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you.
Yeah.
You are here. Miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are
touching every heart.
Oh, just kidding. I worship you.
I worship you.
I worship you.
I worship you.
You are here.
You are here. Healing every heart.
I worship you.
I worship you.
I worship you.
I worship you.
You are here.
You
yeah.
are here. Turning lives around.
I worship you.
I worship you.
I worship you.
I worship you.
You are here.
You are here.
Mending every heart.
Mending every heart.
I worship you.
I worship you.
Take it up.
I worship you. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are.
You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working.
You never stop, you never stop working.
You never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, That is who you are.
That is who you are.
That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are.
Rhythmic right here.
That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are.
Was your foe still afar from me? You've been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You've been so, so kind to me. Till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Still you give yourself away. All the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Let's do a little bit of Ohala of Jesus.
I love to sing its worth. It sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me.
Second verse.
It tells me of a Savior's love, the God to set me free. How I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me.
Yes. I stand. So we're starting. I stand to praise you, but I fall on my knees. My spirit is willing, but my flesh is so weak. Like the fire, my soul. Did y'all hear what Brandon said? He said, are we coming in on, but I fall on my knees. That's a good place to come in. So I stand to praise you, but I fall on my knees. My spirit is willing, soft, yeah, but my flesh is so weak.
A little bit louder for the chorus, a little bit louder.
Light the fire in my soul, fan the flame, make me whole. Lord, you know. Because he first tells me of a Savior's love who died to set me free. It tells me of his precious blood, the sinner's perfect pleasing. Oh, oh, how I love Jesus.
Do you love him?
Oh, how I love Jesus.
Sing it out if you love him.
Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved.
Good.
Thank you. Nine, okay. Yeah, just make sure it's minimal in the house, but make sure it's good and strong on the stream. This will be Laurie's mic and Bob Bentley's mic for communion and the elder mic at the end. Good? Okay, thanks.
Good morning, church. So good to be with you guys this morning. Thank you for joining us online. And as always, just take a moment real quick to go down to the bottom of that Facebook screen you're looking at and hit the share button. We want to make sure that people can find this page and join us on our stream. It's such a good blessing to be with you guys this morning, to be able to bless God in worship, even though we're far apart. Even though we are many, we are one this morning. And I'm so glad to be here this morning to get to worship alongside you, to get to hear what Brandon Bell is going to be talking to us about today, about loving God and loving others, to get to be a part of God's mission, even though we're imperfect, even though we have sin. Looking forward to our children's moment today. It's going to be fun and exciting. And I'm also looking forward to worshiping alongside you guys in spirit. Let's open this morning with prayer. Father God, thank you for calling us together today. Father God, for loving us. Father, as we struggle through what this world has brought us in terms of this virus, this different way of living life, Father, help us to make decisions about what we do that honor you. As we consider coming back, Father, as we share our feedback with one another through our surveys and our conversations, Father, we pray that you will guide us as a church to know what is best, to love you, to love each other, and to love those outside of this church, to love the culture that we live in and the people that we interact with. Father, this morning as we sing songs, as we take communion, as we hear your word, Father. We ask that your Holy Spirit come into us. Father, bless us, encourage us, that we may be your servants here on earth, your ambassadors, Father, as we seek to reconcile this world alongside you. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, those of you guys watching. Let us worship together.
I stand to praise you. But I fall on my knees, my spirit is willing, but my flesh is so weak, like the fire in my soul. In my heart again, I feel your arms around me as the power of your healing begins. You breathe new life right through me like a mighty rushing wind. So light the fire in my soul. Oh, how I love Jesus.
worship you because you are the great I am. You are the King of Kings, and you have blessed us with so much. And we are so grateful. Even when we don't know what to do, we know that we can look to you because you are a way maker. We thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Never stop working. go. We okay there? Okay. Welcome to our time of communion, a time when really we go back to when Jesus was with his disciples and he ate, he broke the bread and he drank from the cup. And in a way, we are also following his command, because when he told them, do this in remembrance of me, we are remembering him today as we focus on the cross. Our scripture reading will be from Luke chapter 23, verse 32, and then we'll skip to verse 39, where it says this: two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there, along with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. Then going over to verse 39, one of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us. But the other criminal rebuked him. Don't you fear God, he said, since you are under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus answered him, truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. For the sun stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. When he said this, he breathed his last. So Jesus died there on the cross. And you could say, in general, he died for all of us. He died for all of mankind, showing his love. But I want to point out today, he also showed it in a more specific way. So right there, while he was in suffering and pain, to the ones who had falsely accused him, to the ones who had spit on him and beat him and even nailed him to the cross, he said, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. And then, more specifically, to the two criminals who both hurled insults at him, Matthew tells us, he said to the one, or one of them finally came to his senses and said, Jesus, remember me. And Jesus even forgave him and said, today you'll be with me in paradise. You know, I know at the times in my life where I've been in some kind of extreme pain, I usually cannot think about other people. I'm usually just thinking about trying to find some relief from my pain. But Jesus showed his extreme love for people when he continued to think about them and forgive them. He showed his love for God by yielding and going to the cross, and he showed his love for individuals, for all of us, even to the very end. What amazing love. We want to be thankful for that time as we take our communion today. Let's pray. Dear God, we stand in awe at your amazing love for us. It's a love that we can't even really comprehend, but we try to as we think about what you've done for us at the cross. Today, we want to claim that love and put it in our heart and live it, and to know that we are your beloved. And through that love, may it be shown out in our lives to all that we meet today. We thank you for Jesus as we eat and as we drink. In his wonderful name we pray. Amen.
The fire. A changed man. Saul did not like Jesus' followers. He was on his way to put some of them in jail. Suddenly, a bright light flashed around him. He fell to the ground. A loud voice asked, "Saul, why are you against me?" Saul was afraid. He cried out, "Who are you?" "I am Jesus, the one you are against. Go to Damascus, and you will be told what to do." When Saul got up, he could not see. Some men who were traveling with Saul led him to the city. Jesus also appeared to a man named Ananias. Jesus led Ananias to Saul. Ananias laid his hands on Saul and said, "Jesus sent me to you. You may see again. Be filled with the Holy Spirit." Immediately, Saul could see. Ananias baptized him. After this, God changed Saul's name to Paul. He was a new man. Instead of hating Jesus' followers, he loved them and became one too.
Ready?
Yep.
Hey. Okay, shake your hands out. Repeat after me. Honor God.
Honor God.
One God.
No idols.
Respect God's name.
Remember to worship every day.
Obey your mom and dad.
No killing.
Stay with the one you're married to.
No stealing.
No lying.
And don't want other people's things. Sing Father Abraham.
Father Abraham had many sons and daughters too, and many sons have Father Abraham. And I am one of them, and so are you, and you, and you. So let's all praise the Lord right on. Father Abraham had many sons and daughters too, and many sons have Father Abraham. And I am one of them, and so are you, and you, and you. So let's all praise the Lord. Right arm, left arm. Father Abraham had many sons and daughters too. And many sons have Father Abraham. I am one of them. And so are you, and you, and you. So let's all praise the Lord. Right arm, left arm, right foot. Father Abraham had many sons and daughters too. And many sons have Father Abraham. And I am one of them, and so are you, and you, and you. So let's all praise the Lord. Right arm, left arm, right foot, left foot. Father Abraham had many sons and daughters too, and many sons had Father Abraham. And I am one of them, and so are you, and you, and you. So let's all praise the Lord. Right arm, right foot, left foot. Nod your head, Father Abraham, and many sons and daughters too, and many sons have Father Abraham, and I am one of them, and so are you, and you, and you. So let's all praise the Lord. Right arm, right foot, left foot. Nod your head, turn around, Father Abraham, and many sons and many sons have Father Abraham, and I am one of them. And so are you, and you, and you. So let's all praise the Lord. Right arm, left arm, right foot, left foot. Nod your head, turn around, sit down.
And that song is a shout out to Ella Flippin. She wanted us to sing that this week, so we did it. Now let's sing Fruit of the Spirit. Jabari, I want you to pick the first fruit, okay?
Okay.
Okay. The fruit of the Spirit, daughter.
Mango.
Mango.
Do the tango. The fruit of the Spirit is not a mango.
Mango.
Do the tango.
If you want to be a mango. Mango. Do the tango. You might as well hear it. You can't be a fruit of the Spirit, because the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Kiwi.
repeat after me. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for Jesus.
Thank you for Jesus.
Thank you for our church family.
Thank you for our church family.
Thank you for our friends.
Thank you for our friends.
Thank you for our dogs and our cats.
Thank you for our dogs and our cats.
Thank you for everything you made.
Thank you for everything you made.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending breath. Chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God. When I was your foe, still your love so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You have been so, so kind to me.
Sing it out.
Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, I still
So God, as we go through this journey, make us more and more like you. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hi, Lorelai. You did such an awesome job during the children's moment. So I wanted you to be with me here at the start of the sermon. I just want to ask you a simple question. Could you tell everybody watching at home what the golden rule is? What is the golden rule?
The golden rule is treat others the way you want to be treated.
Perfect. Thank you so much. Great job, everybody. Everybody at home, give her a hand. Good job. Thank you. So I have a funny story about the golden rule. I found this website. It's called Freedom From Religion Foundation. I think it's .com or something. And they're one of these organizations that they've got a very skewed, a misunderstanding of what the separation of church and state really means. And so it's kind of a watchdog group. It's a place where if you're at a football game and somebody says a prayer, you can go on their site and you can tattletale, and they'll stick their lawyers on the school district. It's that kind of group. And so I had an idea a while back to go on there and make false reports, to make reports that are just totally sarcastic. I figure, you know, the Holy Spirit can speak through sarcasm, I think, anyway. And if nothing else, I figure it's probably wasting somebody's time who's going through and reading all these. So what I did is I reported on my elementary school. I said, I want to make a report against Beltline Elementary in DeSoto, Texas, where I attended elementary back in the late 80s, early 90s, because I distinctly remember on the wall in my classrooms, the golden rule was posted. Treat others the way that you want to be treated. And I begin to tell them that this is an actual quote, word for word, from Jesus in the Bible, in Matthew 7:12. So in everything, do to others what you would have them do to you. For this sums up the law and the prophets. It's not just a quote from Jesus. This basically summarizes the foundational morals of Judeo-Christian value. It's the summary according to Jesus, and this is posted on the wall of the school. And then, just in case they were missing my sarcasm, I really laid it on thick with my final statement. I said, can you imagine a world where people actually did this? Can you imagine living in a place where people actually treated others the way they wanted to be treated? I never got a reply, so I'm assuming they picked up on my sarcasm. I realized I wasn't serious and I was trying to prove a point. You know, I find it interesting that the golden rule is something that no matter what your religion or lack thereof, we can all agree pretty much. I mean, that is just a solid foundation of our human moral expectation. I think it's just ingrained in us. And certainly we don't see a world that's practicing it, sadly. But I think deep inside, every single one of us desire it and recognize that this is a good thing, that this is what we should be doing. And I find it very interesting that many people, many secular people, can quote the golden rule, and they probably don't realize they're quoting Jesus himself. In fact, they probably don't realize that this is one of the great commands. The love others up here. Love God and love others. They may not believe in the God that the first command calls us to, but they certainly agree with the second part of that. Think about how closely tied the golden rule is to the greatest commands. We've been in the greatest commands, and this time we're going to look at Mark's account, the gospel according to Mark, Mark 12. We're going to start in verse 28. So one of the teachers of the law came and heard them debating. Noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer, he asked him, of all the commandments, which is the most important? The most important one, answered Jesus, is this. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this. Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. Well said, teacher. The man replied, you are right in saying that God is one and there is no other but him. And to love him with all your heart and with all your understanding, with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself is most important. It's more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices. When Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, you are not far from the kingdom of God. And from then on, no one dared ask him any more questions. I love that part. It's a drop the mic. Jesus just dropped the mic on him, right? No one dared ask him any more questions. Jesus teaches this in his ministry, and it's reiterated throughout the rest of the New Testament from all the other apostles and the letters to the church, is this concept that we love God by loving others, that loving others sums up all that the law and the prophets were teaching us. And it makes it so nice and simple, doesn't it? Because if you think about the Ten Commandments, just like the children earlier, Mrs. Lori, she's reminding us that the Ten Commandments teach us to do exactly this. You can sum up those commandments. The first four are all about loving God directly and honoring and worshiping him. And the next are about loving others, loving your neighbor as yourself. And if you think about it, you know, Christianity can often get complicated. We talked about at the very first lesson in Be the And in this series, we talked about how confusing Christianity can be to so many people outside the church and even inside the church. But if we run it through the greatest command filter, it makes it pretty simple. If everything I do, say, or think, if I can run it through this filter, does this honor and love God? Does this honor and love others? It makes it pretty simple. You know, this new covenant God's called us to, I believe that these great commands are absolutely written on our hearts. This is explained in Hebrews chapter 8. If you want to read along with me, in Hebrews chapter 8, starting in verse 7, the whole chapter, you really get the full concept, but we're going to start in verse 7. For if there had been nothing wrong with that first covenant, no place would have been sought for another. But God found fault with the people, and he said, now at this point he's quoting Jeremiah 31. In the prophet Jeremiah 31, he says, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand and led them out of Egypt, because they did not remain faithful to my covenant. And I turned away from them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant I will establish with the people of Israel. After that time, declares the Lord, I will put my laws in their minds. I will write them on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. No longer will they teach their neighbor or say to one another, know the Lord, because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest. For I will forgive their wickedness, and I will remember their sins no more. You see, the new covenant is written on our hearts because the new covenant is a relationship. It's not a new religion. It's not a new system. It's a relationship with God, and that's exactly what these greatest commands are. They're in the context. We live out these commands in the context of a relationship with God and a relationship with his children. But there's a problem. As we strive to follow these great commands, as we strive to love God and love others, that can get out of balance a bit. And when the great commands get out of balance, the and is no longer an and. This and gets replaced with an or. We find ourselves approaching it like we got the choice here, love God or love others. And we see these examples throughout Scripture. We see these examples today during Jesus' time, during Jesus' ministry. There was this group of religious leaders, the Pharisees, the scribes, the lawyers, the Sadducees, the Jewish leaders at the time. They were kind of a blaring example of what it meant to get this and out of balance and letting it become an or. Because they claimed to love God. They claimed to honor God. I mean, they devoted everything in their lives to following the law and dotting every I and crossing every T, but it came at the expense of other people. They weren't that great at loving others. And Jesus would call them out on that. He said, you guys are so detailed with your tithing. You're even tithing your herbs and your spices and being extremely exact with that, but you're neglecting your own family. You're telling your aging elderly parents, I'm sorry, I don't have anything to give you. I can't take care of you because I've given it all to the Lord. And one of the most hypocritical examples was the way they treated the Sabbath. The Sabbath day, that's a big one. That's one of the Ten Commandments. You've got to rest. You've got to keep it set apart and holy. It's a day of worship. And Jesus comes along, and in their interpretation of the law, he breaks the law by healing people. He heals people on the Sabbath. Are they excited for this person who's now jumping and running and praising God and rejoicing for the first time in their lives being able to walk because Jesus just spoke the word and they were healed? No, they're angry. They're angry because Jesus broke the rules. And now to add even more hypocrisy to it, they're now trying to plot ways to kill him because he broke the rules. It's this total void of loving others in the claim of loving God, and it's not loving God at all. Now, what about the other side of that? I think it's a problem. I think the Pharisaical mindset, the loving God instead of or at the expense of loving others, I think it's a problem that we today as Christians still have. But I think the other side of that is also a big problem, where we actually love people a little more than we love God. And we wouldn't admit that, but that's kind of how it comes across when we look at God's law and we say, okay, God, yes, you've called us to holiness, you've called us to be pure, you've called us to certain standards of the way we use our bodies, but what about these people over here that don't really agree, they don't really line up with you? I love these people too much, so now I'm going to discredit your word, God. I'm going to explain your word away so that it fits with these lifestyles. It fits with these sinful practices that I want or that these people want. Surely this is okay, right? And so we start to lower God's authority. And we get that out of balance. I'm sure to God it looks like we love people more than we love God when that's our approach. So now, if you've been a Christian long at all, you've heard 100 messages, 100 sermons on the greatest commands. And so we're going to dive down a little deeper into these, what it means to love God and love others, but we're going to come about it from a different direction. I actually want to come about it from a direction of what does it mean, what does it look like to not love God? What does that look like? Well, in John chapter 14, verse 15, Jesus says, "If you love me, keep my commands." Pretty cut and dry. There's not a lot of wiggle room. There's not a lot of room for a lawyer to come in there and be like, well, he doesn't really mean that. What he means is in the Greek, it's, no, it's, if you love me, you'll do what I say. If you love me, you'll keep my commands. It's very cut and dry. But yet, what do we do in response? We may not live in total rebellion. As followers of Jesus, we may not just go all out off the rails like the prodigal son example. For some of us, that's our story, and God's redeemed us and brought us back. But for many of us, we're trying to follow the commands. We're trying our best to love God and love others. But we do a lot of, yeah, but Lord, what can I get away with? Can I be a Christian but still do this? And I want to look at this analogy. Walk through this analogy with me. And I think it's very fitting. Imagine me going to my wife. Imagine me going to my wife, who I love very much, and I walk up to Heather and I say, "Look, babe, we're about to have our 15th wedding anniversary in just like 2 weeks, okay?" And I say, "Honey, look, you know I love you. There's no question. You know I love you. You're my best friend. You're an awesome wife. You're an awesome mother. I'm not going anywhere, okay? But here's the deal. I want to know what I can get away with. I'm not trying to get husband of the year here, okay? I just want to pass with a 70. Maybe even a 69.5 and hope you round up. You know, I just want our marriage to be just saved by grace. I want to do the very minimum, and I want to get away with the most and come just short of you up and leaving me. So, you know, can I flirt with other women? Can I date other women? Can I go out with other women? As long as we don't cross certain lines physically, as long as I'm not intimate. Can I abuse you verbally as long as it's not physically? How about I treat you really good in public, but behind closed doors I treat you horrible? Can every night be guys' night, right? Every night I'm out with the guys, you take care of the kids, you take care of the house, it should be fine. Now, I don't know one person who would look at me as a husband and say, "Man, that's a guy who really loves his wife." In fact, I can feel it right now through this camera. There are some women taking off their earrings. They're ready to fight just thinking about this, right? I mean, that's a terrible marriage. That's not love. If I really love my wife, I would go to her and say, Heather, you're the mother of my children, and I love you, and you're my best friend. I want to know, how can I honor you the most? How can I love you to the fullest? What does that look like? How can I love you to the best of my ability? Isn't that what we do with God? I mean, it sounds ridiculous in the marriage context, but isn't that what we do with God? God, can I be a Christian but still do X, Y, and Z? Can I be a Christian but still act like the rest of the world? What's the least I can do? What's the most I can get away with? Instead of, God, you love me so much, how can I show you my love to the fullest? How can I honor you to the best I possibly can? And let me tell you, this is a battle I struggle with, and I've struggled with all my life, growing up very legalistic, wanting to know how I can form the law to fit my likings instead of just responding to the reckless, overwhelming love of God with a pure, genuine heart and love. When I think about not loving God and what that looks like, I'm reminded of a movie, Bruce Almighty. Bo had to remind me how old that movie is. I don't feel like it's very old, but I guess that means I'm old. It's kind of controversial, honestly. I understand if you didn't see it because you couldn't stand the idea of God being played by a man in a movie. I get it. But honestly, the movie had some really redeeming qualities and some powerful lessons. And the most powerful to me was this scene towards the end. So just to set it up, God is played by Morgan Freeman, and God allows Jim Carrey in the movie to have his powers temporarily. But he gives him a rule. He says, you cannot mess with free will. Well, over the course of the movie, he totally messes up. He lets the power go to his head, and his life just is spinning out of control. And so his girlfriend, who's played by Jennifer Aniston, she totally falls out of love with him, and she leaves him. And he's heartbroken. And because he still is madly in love with her, and he's trying so bad to get her to love him, and he can't. And he's even trying to use his powers he's been given in a very Jim Carrey way, like, love me, you know, like, it's not working. And so towards the end of the movie, he's just pouring out his heart to God, and he's so upset. He says, how can you make someone love you without affecting free will? And Morgan Freeman he smiles this sad smile. And he says, welcome to my world, son. When you get that figured out, you let me know. And I remember watching that movie, and it just hit me like a tidal wave. I was like, oh, my word. Because I know that feeling. I know that sorry, miserable, awful feeling of loving somebody who doesn't love you back. And to think about how much better and how much more God loves people than I could ever love them. And to not have that love returned times billions. Billions. Only time I've ever cried in a Jim Carrey movie. I promise you. Only time. But when I go to that place, when I think about what it looks like to not love God, I don't know about you, but what I know it does for me is it motivates and stirs this love for God in my heart. It makes me want to love God more and more and more. So let's talk about what else it means to not love God. To not love God, what that looks like is the other side of the sand. It means to not love other people. Look at 1 John chapter 4, starting in verse 7. It's a lengthy passage, but honestly, you guys, you don't even need this sermon. Just read 1 John 4, 7 through 21. And I mean, this says it all right here. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God shows his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. This is how we know that we live in him, and he lives in us. He has given us his Spirit. And we have seen and testify that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them, and they live in God. And so we know and rely on the love that God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in them. This is how love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. In this world, we are like Jesus. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. Whoever claims to love God yet hates his brother or sister is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. And he has given us this command: anyone who loves God must also love their brother and their sister. There it is right there, the full summary. If we love God, we've got to love others. But what does not loving others look like? Well, the world's examples, we know those all too well. It's what's all over the news headlines, right? Not loving other people, the world's version, that looks like violence, assault, genocide, murder, rape, racism, trafficking, slavery, theft, corruption. I mean, all those kinds of lists. That's the world's version. But if we're following Christ, if we're trying to live like Jesus, nothing on that list that I just mentioned should even be mentioned among us, as Paul would put it. But what's it look like for us? As a Christian, what does not loving other people look like? I believe it looks like apathy. Just a total lack of compassion for other people. Why? What's at the heart of that? What's at the root of that? Selfishness. It's the root of all sin, is that pride and that self-centeredness that our world just celebrates, basically. It's apathy. I mean, there's even some of us that would call ourselves, refer to ourselves as not being people. I'm not a people person, right? In general, I just don't like people. I get it. I'm on Facebook, okay? I get it. But God's called us to love. And I could go on a whole soapbox and sermon on this, but I don't want to go there. I just want to dip my toe in this water for just a minute. I'm really concerned. I'm really concerned because of the influence I see that the world's having on our lack of ability to love as believers, as Christians. So we know the great commands. We know the greatest command. We know we got to love others if we really love God, but it seems like to me it's getting harder. And there's these words by Jesus that I want us to look at really quick. It's Matthew 24, 10 through 12. And these words from Jesus just kind of haunt me. And they really make me uneasy. The context here is Jesus is talking about both the fall of Jerusalem that will be coming soon after he leaves. It's prophetic about what's going to happen specifically to Jerusalem. But also in Matthew 24, he's also talking about the end times. So it's also specific to us living today and not knowing the time or hour when Jesus will return. And in verse 10, he says, at that time, many will turn away from the faith and will betray and hate each other. And many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. In verse 12, because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold. And man, that doesn't set well with me. And here's why. It's because I see it at work in myself. I see it at work in me. And I don't want to stand up here and have a therapy session. I may need to talk to Bo later and set up an appointment. I don't know. But I guess being on Facebook and having 2,000 friends that are just so close, right? I'm connected to so many different people, and I see so many different problems. And there's stuff that I'm watching on the news that weighs so heavy on my heart, because I really do have a compassionate heart. I really do care about people. I'm a people person, right? I love people, but I get to the point where I'm maxed out. I get to the point where I'm just, I don't have the emotional capacity to deal with all the things that I'm aware of. And so my tendency is to just be totally self-absorbed, to be totally focused on myself. And I think since the rise of social media, and now let's layer on top of that this whole social distancing thing that's killing me. Couple all that, and we're talking about swimming as Christians against a very strong current that is really wearing away at our love for one another. It's a problem. But Jesus is the solution. Jesus is the good news, because here's the thing. Jesus is the and. He is. I mean, think about it. In Matthew 25, Jesus is separating the sheep from the goats. He's separating those who will come into eternal life and those who will not. And he's saying, guys, you fed me when I was hungry. You clothed me when I had no clothes. You gave me drink when I was thirsty. You came and visited me. All these things. And they're going, wait, Lord, when did we see that? And he's saying, when you did this to the very least of my people, you were doing that to me. See, Jesus makes it very personal. And the kids' story today was perfect. When Jesus appears to Saul on the road to Damascus, Acts chapter 9, he's headed to go persecute the Christians, to throw them in prison. And Jesus blinds up the light and says, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And I love Jesus' language there, because he doesn't go, hey, Saul, why are you picking on my friends? Why are you persecuting my people, my brothers, my church? No, me. Who are you, Lord? I'm Jesus who you are persecuting. Jesus is that and, God and others. And if we could get a shot of this and sign and the cross, it's no coincidence. It's no coincidence that this and sign is right here below this cross. Because that cross is like an and sign. Because what Jesus accomplished on that cross was bridging God and humanity, something we couldn't do ourselves. He was bridging heaven and he was bridging earth. It was this ministry of reconciliation, which we're going to be talking more about next week. Jesus on that cross is the absolute perfect example of what it means to love God and to love others. That's exactly what he accomplished on that cross. And that's the good news that we share with you this morning. And as we close, I want to close with one more passage and make one final point. 1 John 3:16 through 18. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. If anyone has material possessions and sees a brother or a sister in need but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us not love with words but with actions and in truth. Some translations say, let us not love with empty words but with actions that are sincere. And I just want to say this, it's very easy to quote the greatest commands. It's very easy to sing songs about the greatest commands. It's even easy to get up here and preach on the greatest commands. That's a whole lot harder to live it, to actually put it into action. In fact, I would say that loving God and loving others actually is supernatural. And here's why I say that, because if we really look at love in the context of Jesus and his examples and how he taught about love, there's nothing human about it. Sure, I can love people that love me back, but God's called me to love people that are hard to love. He's called me to love people who don't love me back. He's called me to love God when I don't understand the world falling apart around me and I've got all these questions and I'm still supposed to love and trust God no matter what. I'm supposed to love my neighbor as much as I love myself. I love myself a lot. I don't know if y'all are aware of that. I'm supposed to even love my enemies. I'm supposed to pray for people who are persecuting me? That's not human. That's not normal. But that's why we need the Holy Spirit, guys. Because the fruit of the Spirit, it's not a mango, right, kids? It's love. Stop right there. Fruit of the Spirit is love. And if we think for one second we can follow these greatest commands by our own power and ability, that we can manufacture these feelings of love that will lead us into putting them into actions that are sincere and true, we're fooling ourselves. We've got to have the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will produce in us the love that God is calling us to have for Him, for this world, for our brothers and sisters. We're going to close there, and I want to invite you to pray. I want you to pray with me. Pray for the Holy Spirit to help us live out this kind of love. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for your love. And God, we confess to you right now that so often we have the wrong response to that love. So often we have an attitude of what can we get away with? So often we have an attitude that's so self-centered, seeking glory for ourselves, or trying to do everything by our own power. But God, we just come to you, we just want to hit our knees and confess. We just want to come before you with humility, recognizing, God, that you deserve all the glory, that you deserve all of our love, and recognizing that we need your Spirit. Lord, we're concerned with the world around us. We're concerned with our own lack of love, our own lack of compassion, and we confess that to you. And God, we just pray that you will stir in our hearts by your Holy Spirit, stir in our hearts a love that's much more deep for our brothers and sisters. Allow us to be close, even in this time where we're distanced, we're separated. God, stir in our hearts. Let us look at the world with compassion just the way you have. And Lord, we can't thank you enough for Jesus, for all that he has accomplished. And if there's anybody watching this, Lord, that has not just laid down their lives, who has not accepted your amazing, unconditional love and your saving grace, God, I pray you would touch their hearts right now and lead them to confess to you, to follow you, to be baptized, to have all the sin and selfishness and dirtiness just washed away, to accept your love. And Lord, let us live your love with actions that are sincere, that are empowered by your Holy Spirit. In the powerful name of Jesus, amen.
Good morning, church. So happy to have you all joining us in this worship service this morning. Whether you're a member of Singing Oaks or you've just happened to have found us, we're so glad that you're a part of the worship that we have here today. What a blessing it is. I know for me and my wife and family, as we have a couple of kids with us now at home, when we're able to see all the little numbers of other people who are joining us in worship each Sunday, it just lifts me up. It blesses me to know that we're all in this together, even though we might be a little ways apart. So I just have a few things I want to mention to you this morning. A couple of quick reminders. Number one is the email. You should have received an email survey as a member of this church. We care about your input and your thoughts about the reopening at the right time and the right way of our worship services and being together. So please make sure that you respond to that. If you can respond to that today or tomorrow, that'd be wonderful. If you need a copy of that, you can contact the church office, go to the website, you can find it there. Also, please remember your online giving, very important for us to continue our work. So please make sure you continue to give online during this time. And then I want to mention, we have a few folks who are recovering from surgery this week. Please remember to continue to pray for. One is Blair Noah, Rob and Susie Noah's son had back surgery. Also Rick Fritch recovering from gallbladder surgery, and Kathy Tudor from shoulder surgery. So please continue to pray for those this week for their recovery. Thank you for the team for putting this together today. Brandon, thank you especially for that message. Just a great reminder, what a blessing it is that our God gives us clarity on how we should live life. Look to Jesus. Here's our example. Look to Him. Strive to be like Him. And as you said, easier said than done. It's a challenging life to live. It requires sacrifice and action. That's what we're called for. And just what a beautiful thing it is that we don't have to wonder and strive for and try to seek out and stumble around to figure out, what is it God wants me to do? We've got it. Look to Jesus. That's the kind of life He wants us to live. Tomorrow is Memorial Day, just a wonderful day in our country when we stop and pause and give thanks to those who've given their life for our freedom, for this great country that we live in. So just want to mention that. It fits so well with the sermon today. We're called to love. In John 13, Jesus says, a new command I give you, to love one another. That's how people will know you're my disciple. And in John 15, he says, greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for his friends. So let's just close our prayer, our service today with a prayer of thanksgiving for all those who've given the ultimate sacrifice, and as we remember them this weekend and tomorrow. So let's have a prayer and then we'll be dismissed. Heavenly Father, today we give you thanks for the gift of life, and we give you the glory for giving us that life. Lord, we experience so many blessings through your Son, Jesus. Today we bow our heads to honor and give thanks to those who have given the ultimate sacrifice, and the words of Jesus have demonstrated the greatest love, to give their lives for others. Lord, we're just thankful for families, people that lost loved ones, people who were willing to give their all so that we can experience and enjoy the benefits of freedom in this country. Lord, help us as disciples of yours to live out the words of Jesus, to strive in our actions, to do what to live the lives that you want us to live. Just help us to keep turning our eyes to Jesus, look to Him, and strive to be like Him. And Lord, we ask your Spirit to work through us to make that happen. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.